kids dying quietly on our tree-lined streets in our well-performing school districts. It was Long Island's dirty little secret for a long time, but the secret's out.
I felt that I was haunted and that I was different than everybody else, and I was meant to die with a needle in my arm. That's how I lived, like I was gonna die with a needle in my arm.
Every day my heart was in my throat, knowing he was shooting 10 bags of dope a day. You know, thinking he knew what he needed to do, but he just couldn't bring himself to do it.
In just 5 years, the number of heroin users in the country nearly doubled. Overdose deaths have increased fivefold since 1990, and of those dying, there's a spike between the ages of 15 and 24. The grip is tightening.
Cheaper than a pack of cigarettes and deadlier than anything else we've seen out there to date. We all know how addictive these substances are, whether it's prescription opioids or whether it's heroin. The fact that our kids can get addicted on the very first dose should scare all of us into a sense of reality.
I met a boyfriend at 18. He was using painkillers. I tried them and it was love at first try. I quickly became addicted. My body needed it and I couldn't live without it.
She doesn't look like a heroin addict, right? Well, that's because the face of heroin is changing. Heroin is rocking the futures of our youth. And they're the lucky ones, lucky to be alive, because so many children are dying.
Nearing 100 wakes right now, I would say, in my lifetime. So this is an epidemic. My brothers are dying.
Matt died alone in a Brooklyn SRO hotel. The police found him and called Denise. She called me at work so we could get to the morgue and identify someone else, not Matt. Now we visit Matt at the cemetery. We believe he's not really there, but finally at peace. Someday, we'll all be together again. It's just amazing what you can talk yourself into.
Just a couple of years ago, I had an opportunity to be in one of the communities that I represent, a suburban community on the north shore of Long Island in Nassau County, and we talked about opioid abuse and heroin abuse, and I was told point blank by this parent group that that doesn't happen in my community. No, our kids have a problem with alcohol, maybe a little bit of marijuana, but no, opioids and heroin is not an issue in our suburban community.
Nobody wants to admit to it, but it's in every neighborhood. We all know it, you all see it. They all behind us treat it. And frankly, it's been going on too long.
This is particularly a suburban epidemic, and it is particularly hitting our communities here in Nassau County and Suffolk County, and it's about time we did something about it.
Senator Martins led an informative forum in Suffolk County where field experts, educators, law enforcement, and families shared their personal experiences.
Every person on this panel in some way, shape, or form has either directly affected his recovery process or indirectly by the people that you represent, the schools. He's been in every every program up there, Outreach, Phoenix House, every single one, right down to the Sheriff's Corrections Office.
This concerned community joined together for one purpose, to save lives.
When we think about the other natural disasters, and that's how I look at this, that have hit Long Island, including Hurricane Sandy, in the wake of Sandy, we all, especially these guys to my right, stepped back and said, why weren't we better prepared? What do we need to do as individuals and communities to make sure this devastation never happens again? And nobody was that worried about what it would cost, quite frankly. We did what it took to rebuild.
From the 70s heroin epidemic and the crack cocaine epidemic in the 80s, it does not equal to half of what's going on today. You can look at the sheer numbers. It's actually on par with and surpassing HIV/AIDS right now.
Our story is not unique. We know many friends with similar stories. Some are here today. We need to end the shame and stigma. We need awareness, compassion for these people that are sick, and change.
The Senate Task Force on Heroin and Opioid Addiction has responded with legislation. 25 bills to address the key issues: prevention, treatment, and criminal standards.
There's a fine line that we walk here, and it probably is a razor's edge. If you think about it, you know, on one end, we do not want to glorify the use, and we have to take, I think, a proactive approach when it comes to how it is portrayed in media, in films, on TV. And on the other hand, we don't want to demonize it, nor can we. And so we have to strike the proper balance.
Stigmatizing drug users contributes to the downward spiral. It's hard to admit you have a problem or ask for help if you don't have a good support system. Some will even try to hide their addiction to the extent of avoiding treatment. And we all know accessing treatment is the best shot at recovery.
In my estimation, the reason I was able to be successful and never have a relapse since I started was because I had the opportunity to go to inpatient rehabilitation for 28 days. My insurance company paid for that. We pay premiums for those kinds of things.
If we look at this as a mainstream
correct
health issue like high blood pressure, cholesterol, right, diabetes, any of the other health issues that we would want our healthcare provider to not only identify, but then to provide access right to different
suddenly the barriers
modalities
go away.
And then there is no reason why we would differentiate between one and the other, because
right
if it is a health issue, then it should be treated like any other health issue.
Right.
Of the thousands of people that I assessed for admission, not one of them said to me, you know, I woke up one day and decided I wanted the disease of addiction and I want to be an addict. As a nurse, I also treated people with cancer over the years, and not one of them also said to me, I want the disease of cancer. And yet we respond to these two diseases so differently.
This, there's still a question. This, there's still a stigma. This, people go, no.
That's wrong.
And there's plenty of opportunity to intercede at a much earlier point.
And believe me, you have to go education, you have to educate the kids, you have to do all that. But, you know, my son was 18. You know, I've heard parents, you know, their children, quote unquote, are 23, 25. They need it just as much. They don't have the education, they need it just as much. And that help is there. You know, it could be from a loved one from them, it could be from a parent, it could be from anybody. It just should be part of the general help.
My son is a recovering heroin addict. We've been fighting this disease. I say we because it's a family disease and a family recovery since he's 15 years old.
The old line of thinking is, maybe if we don't address it, the problem will just go away or correct itself. Addiction does not just go away. It is a lifelong disease, and lives are often cut short. These families found this out the hard way.
I'm the proud mom of Peter, who passed away it'll be 40 months ago from a heroin overdose. While he was alive, I would tell him privately how proud I was of him and how hard he was fighting to obtain sobriety and maintain sobriety. Unfortunately, although he had said, Ma, you can tell anyone, I don't care, I chose not to. So what message was I giving him, really? Was I proud?
We printed a poem Matt wrote about addiction on the church funeral pamphlet and told the priest to talk about addiction at his funeral mass. He did. That started it. We wanted to get it out in the open. We wanted to stop the shame.
We have to reach out and be proactive so addicts understand they're not alone.
I'm going to do my little part to try and do something towards shame and stigma. My name is Anthony, and I am a person in long-term recovery for over 20 years through the grace of God, through a loving family, through a 12-step fellowship, and through treatment.
This disease runs in my family. I am a recovering person. I live it, I breathe it, I walk it. And coming from that perspective, I know the importance of talking about it.
My name is Richard Buckman, and the most important thing I could say today is that I'm a person in long-term recovery from addiction since August of 1988.
In following the suits of my colleagues who I respect and admire, I also love to share that the fact that I got sober before it was even legal for me to drink when I was 20 years old. Not something I generally share in public in a venue like this, but in the spirit of today, it is important.
It's an honor to serve with my boyhood friend Art Muir, who was the son to heroin addiction.
That's allowed me to be a father to my son. It's allowed me to be a father to my daughter. It's allowed me to be a husband to my wife. It's allowed me to be a son to my parents. Unless we start doing this, the only thing that people know about addiction is all of the ugliness of it. So it is imperative I reach out to my brothers and sisters that struggle with the same illness. Let people know.
Let's understand that there's a real opportunity here, because as people tell me all the time, you strike while the iron is hot, and it's hot.
This forum set the groundwork for the 25 bills the Senate has developed, so New York can adopt a holistic approach when it comes to heroin and opioid addiction. Senator Martins encourages all of you to read the details of the legislation on Martins.NYsenate.gov.